Blog Talk Radio.
What's going on, y'all? This is Beach Street Sports Talk Radio. I'm your host, Lee, a.k.a. the Hoops Guru. It's been a minute, y'all, but I am back in full effect. There's a lot that's been going on in the sports world since our last show. So let's get into it. And if you want to call and add on to the banter or want to raise the questions or any of those, or just give us your thoughts, give us a call at 347-945-6921. Okay, y'all, the NBA is off and rolling pretty well in the playoffs, and the NFL draft is just completed. And the draft didn't go, I don't think, as according as much people have thought as far as Jadeveon Clowney. People were skeptical if he was going to go first, where Johnny Manziel finally winding up with the Browns at the number 22nd pick, and you know, no running backs being drafted in the first round, things of that nature. Were all very interesting, but I think the headline of the story that probably stole the show at the end of the day was Michael Sam being drafted in the 7th round. I forget which actually number pick he was. And what are my thoughts on him being drafted, being the first quote-unquote openly gay football player in the NFL? I mean, in one regard, it's good to see this finally happen. I don't think your sexuality should ever impede you from having gainful employment or achieving your dreams. So in that regard, I'm pretty happy for him. In the other regard, though, I saw the video of his, you know, I guess when he got the call from the team that he was listed by, I believe it was the Rams, I was a little surprised or taken aback at how he actually received that information. Now, I wasn't walking in his shoes, so I don't want to be too prejudging of what I gather from his reaction, but I thought it was a little over the top, maybe even staged, I might say, because it does seem like endorsements and things are running his way. He's getting a lot of favoritism in that regard. Or maybe he reacted that way for the simple fact that he thought, you know, putting himself out in front of the street may have actually collapsed his dreams, because it looks like he wasn't going to get drafted until the Rams snatched him up very late in the draft. You know, so he's holding his boyfriend's hand, I guess, and they embrace it, a long kiss after that or whatever. I know, you know, reading the comments I've seen on the different blog pages and things of that nature, you know, people are real cynical and hateful about things they don't like or don't understand. And I'm not with that. All I want to say to Michael Sam is don't let your sexuality precede you. You know, and it shouldn't in any field, unless you're a prostitute, that's the only time your sexuality should precede you, because that's what you're defining your success by. But, you know, he should. I don't just want it to be a thing where, yeah, I'm in the NFL, everybody knows I'm gay, but, you know, Michael Sam, but I think at this time now he needs to just focus on being a phenomenal football. And that's where people, you know, and that's where further athletes will be able to do the same thing as he did without being identified as a gay athlete, just an athlete who happens to be gay. I think that's the point where we, you know, this needs to go on where he needs to go. But right now it seems like he's letting his sexuality precede his NFL prowess or his athletic prowess that he proved in college when he was the SEC Defensive Player of the Year. So, you know, hopefully, you know, he evolves into this role and it diminishes as a story, and, you know, he just becomes a guy just like any other person who achieved his dream and made it to the NFL. You know, whether he plays 1 year, 3 years, or 10 years, who knows, but just having an opportunity to perform and be the best he can be without being always connected with his sexuality, because I don't care about, you know, any of the New York Giants sexuality, heterosexual, homo, or otherwise. You know, as fans, we just want you to be able to help the team progress and get better. So that's the same I expect out of Michael Sam and his career, and hopefully from this day forward, he'll be back page information. Also in the NFL, it looks like Vince Young was cut by the Cleveland Browns. So maybe they were going to give this him a flyer at being the starting quarterback for their team for the next year. I would have liked to seen that. Interested in just seeing a Vince Young less arrogant now that he's been removed from his dream. See if, you know, sometimes taking a step back allows us to take a step forward in life. And it seems like he's been trying to really get back to rediscover his former glory. You know, I'm kind of interested in seeing him with the Browns, see where that went. But since Cleveland did get the cash cow named Johnny Manziel, it looks like they're going to ride that wave for this next year. And I guess maybe Vince Young looked good. Maybe he really looked good, and they didn't want to cause any type of quarterback controversy or anything to keep Manziel off the field because, you know, instantly they sold over 2,200 season tickets just by drafting the kid. So I don't know how much Cleveland is interested in winning as opposed to keeping the house packed and the fans rabid. So it seems like that's may have been where this move has come from. What I don't like is – I really don't like how the NFL can just terminate contracts. I mean, what, they signed Vince Young for a few weeks? You know, at least in the NBA, you know, you have to stand by your judgments when you offer a contract, whether you offer a guy a one-year deal or a five-year deal. You know, we can cut you, but you're still going to get paid. And I think the NFL, I don't know if the contract should be partially guaranteed or whatever the case may be, but to me, if you sign a guy, he should, let's say you sign a guy to a 1 or 2 year deal, that the first year of that contract should be definitely guaranteed. You know, if I sign a contract, I should at least be assured that I'm going to be able to be in uniform for that first year. That way, if I don't perform well or otherwise, you know, it seems more justification because there's a body of work to judge it by as opposed to, we signed you, Vince, but you know what? 5 weeks later, cut you. You never even made it to training camp. Thanks, but go home. I'm not feeling that. I think this is a good segue, too. You know, Cleveland Brown. Let's talk about the Cleveland Cavaliers coach, Mike Brown. Keeping it Brown. He was fired today by the Cleveland Cavaliers, second time around. I don't recall how long his contract was with Cleveland. I think it was 4 years, but they got rid of him after 1 year. I believe they won 39 games this year. A little bit surprised by that move. I thought they would give him more time than that. 'Cause let's be honest, that wasn't a stellar roster, you know. Bynum never really gave him anything when he played for him for a little while. Kyrie Irving was in and out of the lineup. The draft pick they gave him, he didn't draft Bennett. Bennett was out of shape and kind of useless for the whole year. So there was nothing he really gained out of that. And even after as terrible as that season was, they were in the chase probably to the last two games or so for being make him that eighth playoff spot. He's not responsible for the roster. And Mike Brown has proven he could take a team to the finals, even though he did have the best player in the world, LeBron James, when he did it. So to me, I think that was a little bit premature. Are they setting the stage to clear things to try to entice LeBron to come back to Cleveland? No one's really talking about LeBron, that he can opt out of his contract the same way Carmelo Anthony can this year. So are they maybe trying to clear the stage for LeBron to come home? I don't think so. I don't know if this roster is attractive enough to him to come back to, and especially after the sour grapes and virtual reaction that the Cleveland fans gave him upon his exodus. So I'm not really sure. But, you know, I like to speculate. I like to look at different angles and things, but things that may possibly happen. So, yeah, Mike Brown fired after 1 year for the Cleveland Cavaliers. It's going to be pretty interesting to see who they try to find to replace him to come there. There's a lot of vacancies in the NBA right now, and I don't think Cleveland's going to be a high priority for a lot of your top-tier coaching candidates. So, we shall see. We'll keep our eye on this as the NBA season progresses, especially after the draft, and see where Cleveland is going to be stacked up as far as coaching is concerned. There's another rumor strong rumor too in the NBA that Stan Van Gundy is the leading candidate for the Golden State Warriors job. I could tell you one thing, man. That would, I think, honestly, that would be a terrible hire for the Golden State Warriors. Mark Jackson has something special going up there in Golden State. I think they were probably one of the most cohesive teams in the NBA. Maybe Miami, the Spurs, the Clippers, I think probably the only teams that probably have a better bond with their coach than what Golden State had with their particular coach. And I don't think that should be taken for granted at all. Also, Stan Van Gundy's kind of been known as a team killer. Like, he'll work you real hard. You'll get a little spike, a bump out of those guys, especially on the defensive end. But eventually, the players grow tired of him, and his voice eventually falls on deaf ears, and he becomes ineffective. We've seen that before with Orlando. We saw it in Miami. So I don't know why. You know, I mean, he has been away from the game. Maybe he's learned something more, but I doubt it seriously. And I think he's just not a good mix for that team. That was a team that did pride themselves on defense, but they also pride themselves on the offensive end as well. I think if he tries to convert these guys into playing like the Chicago Bulls and ruling with an iron fist as opposed to like Mark Jackson did with a kind of fatherly, big brotherly, free spirit approach, will be a shock to their system. I don't think they're going to respond to that well at all. So I think Stan Van Gundy is not the man for that job. I think Stan Van Gundy would be better for the Knicks than he would with the Golden State Warriors, actually, or even like a team like the Washington Wizards right now that are probably need to get rid of their coach and get somebody in there that can have them playing at a higher efficiency so they can bump it up to the next level. But for Golden State, I don't think that's a good hire at all. I don't think he'll produce any more wins than what Mark Jackson had, and I think they might have a minor mutiny on their hand with the players. And, you know, it can lead to the exodus of someone like Klay Thompson or Stephen Curry. So I would definitely stand clear of Stan Van Gundy if I was the Golden State Warriors. Let's transition to the NBA. There were two games in the NBA last night, two game fours. The first one was your afternoon matinee, the Oklahoma City Thunder playing against the Los Angeles Clippers. Great game. The Clippers were able to rally at home and pull out the W, which they had to have, because if they went down 3-1, back to Oklahoma City, you could pretty much say this series is going to be a wrap. But no, it's 2-2. They're heading back to Oklahoma City, and this series has all signs pointing to that it's going to be a seven game series with an epic finish at the Staples Center sometime the end of this week. Oklahoma City had the game pretty much in control. They blew a 16-point lead in the fourth quarter. But being on the road against a Doc Rivers coach team with the talent and veterans they have, I'm going to give Oklahoma City a pass. It's hard to win on the road with a team as talented as the Clippers are. Their record, they're both 50-win game teams, and they're pretty much evenly matched. What I don't like is that it seems like Oklahoma City is just still too heavily relied upon Westbrook and Durant to carry the weight. And I'm just not liking how they're bringing about their young talent. I'd like to see Jeremy Lamb and, what's the young forward's name? He got drafted real low in the draft. I cannot think of his name right now. But the young power forward, they have on the team, I'd like to see him come along a little bit better as well. And also, I'd like to see a lot more Reggie Jackson at the one and Russell Westbrook playing off the ball. So he can maybe kind of facilitate that as opposed to Westbrook being the primary ball handler, because he looks for his shot a little bit too much, especially when he feels like he has it going. But it seems like he always takes a bad shot, too, when he feels like he has it going. The bad shot would be critical to why they will have a particular loss. And I think that's what we saw transpire at the last game. But Oklahoma City's fine. It's 2-2. They have home court advantage again. It's critical game 5 coming up tomorrow. They're at home, so they're – are they at home? Yeah, they're at home. So they're pretty much in the driver's seat. It's still their series to lose. I think this is going to be probably the best series of the second round, its conclusion. Another game was the Wizards hosting the Indiana Pacers. And you talk about a team that just melting down right now and just lost all the mojo they had after they beat the Chicago Bulls in their series and got the first win of this series against the Pacers. The Washington Wizards are, you know, they're just looking like a team that just can't handle whatever Indiana's throwing at them. Hibbert got his wake-up call during the series. I just think there was so much media scrutiny and things of that nature that he was, you know, it seemed like the refereeing in that game 3 allowed him to get his, excuse me, that game 2 allowed him to get his confidence back when he dropped 28 points, which was one short of his career high. This game here, though, is probably a game the Wizards aren't going to be able to come back from. What's the word I'm looking for? Recuperate from. They're just – losses aren't all the same. And when you're up 19 at home early in the third quarter, you have to close that out. By the time the end of the third quarter was over, they were only up 1. The veterans on the Wizards bench, what they call the AARP group, was led by Andre Miller, Al Harrington, and Drew Gooden. They came in there and actually bumped the lead up to 9 points midway through the fourth quarter. Randy Whitman decided to give John Wall back into the game, which is, I understand that, but he didn't bring in the Niagara Tot. So he kind of rolled out with Drew Gooden for a while, and they were just ineffective. Wall was ineffective, hesitant. They were missing open shots, and the Pacers' defense was collapsing the hole. They were really effective, and Paul George finally got loose. I believe he had his career playoff high of 39. I think he was not too far off of his personal career high. I think his career high might be 40, so I'm thinking he was maybe one shy of that as well. So, you know, when you do that at home, in front of your home crowd, it's demoralizing. The Wizards, you know, they left this series split when they left Indiana and lost 2 games at home. So you got to wonder if are John Wall and Bradley Beal pressing at home in front of their fans to prove that they are talented and feel more comfortable on the road, where they're not expected, you know, to hear the cheers, because even in the Chicago series, they won 3 road games and lost a game at home. So you're wondering why this team can't perform well in front of their home fans. And, you know, the Verizon Center was not sold out a lot this year. So maybe it is a little uncomfortable and pressing. You know, when a house is full, you want to prove to your fans and you want to create a culture where there is some excitement in the arena that's just not there yet. I could see for a young point guard and shooting guard how that could be nerve-wracking. But for Nene, Gortat, and these veterans, there's no excuse for that. You know, this last time I checked, Hibbert's not Hakeem Olajuwon. He's not Shaquille O'Neal. So Nene should still be effective. Gortat should still be effective, and they aren't at this point. This is why me, personally, you know, who pays probably more attention to the Wizards than most, feels that the Wizards should really go after Paul Gasol next year. As much as Gortat has been a savior this year for the Wizards, especially, you know, getting or trying him in a trade for Mecca Okafor when the Okafor had the herniated disc in his neck and were pretty much lost for the year, he saved the season for the Wizards, certainly. But, you know, it's all about evolution, getting better, evolving, let's say. And so I think the Wizards are going to have to, in the offseason, look at someone like a Gasol. I think he would be a lot more effective playing aside than they, because Gasol actually has the talent that he could pull someone like Hibbert away from the basket. But he's so effective in the pick and roll and the post game. I think, you know, people forget how talented Paul Gasol really is. wasted a year or two with D'Antoni, having him think he's Chris Bosh or, I don't know, some other three-point shooting specialist, and not really using the full spectrum of what this Hall of Famer Paul Gasol really is. So we're going on a little tangent here, but I'm just thinking about some improvements the Wizards should make or upgrades they can make in the offseason. I'm sure Gortat's going to be a heavily coveted free agent, so they may lose him anyway. Then he may get overpaid. I don't think they should do that. They can maybe get Gasol for the same money if he's interested in leaving the Lakers. We'll see. Before I get out of here, I guess we need to talk about the two games that I want to chat for tonight. You have the Heat and Brooklyn, game four. This game is going to be very interesting because over the course of the season, what we're seeing is that Brooklyn has gotten progressively better as the season has progressed. They got blown out in game one. Game two, they were competitive but kind of collapsed at the end. Game three, they put on a good show in front of their home crowd and were effective. I think they learned some things playing against the Heat, that they have to have a post presence. They have to play an inside-out game with a team like the Miami Heat. Andre Blatcher attacking Chris Bosh was highly effective. I think that's what allowed the spacing for Brooklyn to hit those 15 three-pointers, that they were able to kick it out from the post and swing it around for open shots. The rookie Telavich needs to still be aggressive, looking for his open shots, but I'm sure they're going to try to clamp down on him as far as the Heat are concerned. So, you know, they always make great adjustments. They're probably the best adjustment-making team in the NBA. So the Nets aren't going to be able to go with the same game plan. So I expect to see inspired LeBron James and very active Miami defense. It's going to be an interesting game, though. I'll tell you one thing. If Brooklyn wins this game tonight, it's going to be in for a very interesting series because I think at first a lot of people were saying that they don't have a chance. It's going to be a sweep. But if Brooklyn wins two at home and they start, you know, believing in themselves again, that size, yeah, you know what, yeah, we did beat this team four times in the regular season, I think that might creep in the back of Miami's mind as well. So I think Miami just is going to come out on fire and try to just put a stranglehold on this series tonight to get a 3-1 lead. So still haven't seen Kevin Garnett show up in the series, you know, on the offensive end. So that's going to be interesting to see what he brings tonight. Pierce has been stable, but he hasn't been what we've seen of him in the past. So I want to see if he'll be able to muster up a better effort tonight as well. But that's the beauty of the NBA, the same playing the seven-game series. Just to go, you know, again, a series ending 2-2 as opposed to 3-1 is a huge, 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 huge difference. It really is. And, you know, Brooklyn really had the chance to turn the tide in this series, and Miami had the chance to really put a stranglehold on this series and go home and put the series to bed. So this is going to be a fun game. It's definitely a game I'll be watching tonight. So that's all I got to say about that particular series. Finally, the last thing we'll talk about is the Spurs. They're hosting Portland tonight, and if you're in the Western Conference, man, you got to be kind of scared right now because the Spurs are looking like they're on a mission. I mean, it's funny because when I was a younger guy, I didn't really like the Spurs that much. But as I'm a little older and a little more seasoned or savvy or aware of, you know, basketball play, I've come to love to watch the Spurs, really just their ball movement, their unselfishness, the way they work together defensively, offensively as well, just how to always even kill, that how Popovich isn't afraid to go into his bench and things that nature, and how they can make a team like Portland look like a team that didn't look like a team that should be in the lottery. You know, as opposed when we saw Portland the previous round against Houston, they looked like they could go to the NBA Finals against Houston, but then again, that's the difference between a team that's solely focused on just scoring points and shooting the three in a perimeter game like Houston, as opposed to a well-balanced, veteran-savvy, championship-caliber team. Like, they'll find your weakness and totally exploit it. And that's what makes the Spurs so great. So I think it's going to be they're going to get a good effort from Portland tonight. It's going to be all about weathering the storm. If they weather the storm in the first quarter and it's even or the Spurs are up, I think it's good night to Portland, and the brooms are coming out. Portland can come out that first quarter, maybe, energized, feeding off that crowd, have a 6-8 or more point lead. I think they'll be okay. And I think they'll be able to squeeze a win out. But a team like the Spurs, especially that sees the opportunity of getting some good rest ahead of themselves, pretty much takes advantage of these situations always. So we'll not be surprised at all to see the San Antonio Spurs close this one out tonight. So that's pretty much it, y'all. I really appreciate everybody tuning into the show. We'll get to a show again later on this week. We'll definitely have shows every Monday and every Friday. There's a lot of things going on.
You can tell everybody.
But,
turn it.